Bellman-Ford algorithm, A-star algorithm, and Floyd-Warshall algorithm. If you've never heard about any of these, don't worry about it. You see, I have interviewed at all these companies and got offers from Google, Facebook, Amazon, and some others. If there is one thing I've learned from my experience, it's this. You do not need to know every single algorithm in this world to crack coding interviews. In most interviews, they're asking you very similar kind of questions. And if you've heard of 80-20 rule or Pareto's principle, you know that 20% of algorithms will be asked in 80% of the interviews. In this video, I'll tell you top 5 algorithms I was asked in my coding interviews so that you can pick your top 20% algorithms yourself. I'll also share the exact problems where these algorithms can be applied. This video is going to be very information dense.
Pay attention.
At number 5, we have top k elements algorithm. Top k elements algorithm shows up in different problems. Finding the k largest or smallest numbers in an array, or finding the k most frequent numbers in an array are some example problems where you would need to know this algorithm. It also shows up in some sliding window problems. We'll cover sliding windows shortly. For the purpose of this video, let's look at finding the k largest numbers in an array. Sorting the array and taking the k largest elements is one way of doing it. But it's not optimal because time complexity or big O of doing this would be n log n. And we can do better than that. That's why in the top k elements algorithm, we use a heap data structure to track top k largest elements. Now, if you don't know what a heap is and you want me to make a video on top 5 most asked data structures, let me know in the comments. For simplicity, just know that heap is a collection of numbers that makes getting the maximum or minimum number very efficient. In the top k elements algorithm, we add the first k numbers of the array on a heap. For every number after that, we add it to the heap, and right after doing that, we remove the minimum number from the heap. This way, we maintain the heap size of k, and the heap always contains the largest k numbers we have seen so far. This step of adding and removing the number to the heap has a big O of log k, and we do this for every number in the array, which is n times. So the big O of top k elements algorithm is n log k, which is better than n log n, which we got through sorting. At number 4, we have the sliding window algorithm. This algorithm shows up in many problems like largest substring without repeating characters, maximum sum subarray of size k, and largest substring with k distinct characters. Here we will learn the sliding window algorithm using the largest substring without repeating characters problem. In this problem, you're given a string and you need to return the largest substring such that all the characters in it are unique. You can pause the video if you need some time to understand the problem better. In the first step, we initialize two pointers left and right at the beginning of the array. Now we increment the right pointer to expand the window between left and right. As we do this, we store the information of all the characters present inside the window. We keep incrementing the right pointer and updating this information until we find a character that is already present in the window. We have reached the maximum window size because the right index cannot be part of this window due to the repeating character. So we will update the answer here. Now we start shrinking the window by incrementing the left character until the repeating character goes outside the window. As we increment the left pointer, we will remove the characters that are no longer part of the window from the stored information. Once the left pointer reaches its final state, we can start incrementing the right pointer again to expand the window and repeat this process. We keep doing this until the right pointer goes outside the range of the array. To help you understand this algorithm better, I will provide a link to the code in the description. At number 3, we have backtracking. In backtracking, we explore all possible solutions by building them step by step. When we reach an invalid state, we backtrack or go back and start exploring the other possible solutions. Backtracking is usually implemented using recursion. I know that none of this makes any sense right now. So let's understand backtracking with the help of a very famous problem called combination sum. In this problem, we are given a list of positive numbers and a target sum. You need to pick some numbers from the list so that they add up to the target sum. In the end, you have to return all the unique ways or combinations that add up to the target sum. You're allowed to pick a number more than once. In this example, 2, 3, and 3 add up to the target sum of 8. So it's one of the combinations in the answer. Pause the video if you need some time to understand the problem better. To solve this problem, let's create different combinations from scratch. We start at index 0 with an empty combination and current combination sum of 0. Whenever the total sum of combination is more than target, we backtrack or return because adding more positive numbers to the combination will only increase the combination sum and can't lead to a valid answer. If the combination sum is same as the target, we add the current combination to the answer and return. Otherwise, for every number that comes after current index, we add the number to the combination, update the combination sum, update the current index and call the function recursively. Updating the current index ensures that we only get unique combinations in the answer. I will link this code in the description for you to look at. Backtracking is used in many problems like word ladder, permutations, and Sudoku solver. At number 2, we have dynamic programming. In backtracking, we explored all possible solutions from scratch step by step. In dynamic programming, however, we are more thoughtful about the solutions that we explore while still building them from scratch, and we do this by breaking the problem into smaller sub-problems. Let's take the example of combination sum again and see how we will solve it with the help of dynamic programming this time. The problem asks us to find all possible unique combinations that add up to the target sum using all the given numbers. But let me change the problem a little bit. Imagine that I give you all the combinations that add up to target sum minus 1, target sum minus 2, and so on, using all the given numbers except the last one. In other words, you know all the unique ways to make numbers from 1 to target using all the given numbers except the last one. And now, I give you the last number. Can you use this information to find all the unique combinations that add up to target using all the given numbers including the last one? You can pause the video and take a moment to think. You can start from the left until you reach the target sum equal to last number. Do nothing. For the target sum equal to last number, you can simply add the last number by itself as a new combination. For the target sum equal to last number plus 1, you can just add the last number to all the combinations that add up to 1, and all those combinations would now add up to last number plus 1. Add the last number to all the combinations with target sum equal to 2, and all those combinations would now add up to last number plus 2. And you can keep doing this until you reach the target sum. And voila! You have found your answer. If you look at the code, you can keep track of all the sums from 1 to target using this array. For target sum equal to 0, add a combination which is an empty list. Now start with the first number and keep adding more numbers with this for loop. And for a particular target sum, just add more combinations using all the combinations for target sum minus current number. I will leave a link to this code in the description. At the very top, we have breadth first search and depth first search. I have kept them together because both of them are used for graph traversal and are very similar. Let's start with depth first search, or DFS. In DFS, you start from a vertex and explore as far as possible along each branch. If you reach a point where there is no unvisited neighboring vertex to explore, you backtrack and try to find another branch that is unvisited. In breadth first search or BFS, you explore the neighboring vertex first before moving on to the other deeper unvisited vertices. DFS is implemented using a stack, whereas BFS is implemented using a queue. That's because in DFS, you want to explore the neighbors of the last vertex that you visited first. So you want last in, first out, which is what stack does. In BFS, however, you want to explore the neighbors of the first vertex that you visited first. So you want first in, first out, which is what queues are for. I will link a couple of videos in the description that will explain this in much more detail. BFS is used to find the shortest path from vertex A to vertex B. Another famous algorithm that does the same is Dijkstra's algorithm. An algorithm that is closely related to DFS and is a must for coding interviews is topological sort. I recommend you to read Dijkstra's algorithm and topological sort on your own. To master all the algorithms that we discussed today, you need to have a deep understanding of data structures. And you cannot crack all coding interviews just with these 5 algorithms, obviously. If you want to know how I mastered data structures and algorithms, watch this video. My name is Sahil, and I'll see you in the next one.